Well, I'm not used to having the lights on me like this. Can we dim them just a little bit? Is that possible? How many of you like change? Raise your hand if you like change. Well, there's a few of you mentally ill among us. Before I get into the word, I just want to lay a thought in front of you. If you think you're going through a lot of change right now, think of what the change that Jesus went through and stepping out of the glories of heaven and walking on earth. Just imagine, from a throne to a stable, from eternity to an existence where, you know, time was no more in heaven, and it will be for us someday, but stepping into human existence and human frailty and human difficulty. Yes, he was the Son of God, but he was also the Son of Man. Eternal life to death on a cross. And we know he rose again, and he ascended into heaven, and he returned to that, rightfully to that right throne of the hand of God. But consider the same. The change that Jesus experienced. Paul put it this way. Though he could have grasped equality with God, he emptied himself and took on the form of a servant and was obedient even to the point of death on a cross. Talk about change. Talk about demotion and the emotions that went along with that. So, maybe some of the changes that God asks us to experience are pretty small compared to the changes that Jesus experienced. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, as we open your word, that as I prayed much in preparation for this message, what word do you want me to share? Because I have such a heart for this place and people. So much happened in our lives while we were here. And every time I come here, I remember some of the grief of my soul when you called us away and the struggle we experienced during that time of change. But thank you that you're faithful here 25 years later. We can all turn around and say, wow, God knew what he was doing. And we praise you for that wisdom and faithfulness, direction, supply, both spiritually to our souls and to the needs. Here we are. And God, there is another season of change. And we ask that you would bless in the midst of it, and we ask that you would help us to have not just our perspective, because from an earthly perspective, change is very difficult. Some of us, and I include myself in that, do not like change. We look at it and it's not something we want to wrap our arms around and say, oh, Lord, do some more change. So bless this message to our heart. Help us to gain a perspective of heaven and how we need to work in the midst of that, live in the midst of that, talk in the midst of that. What do you want us to do? And at the end of this message, I pray that we'll be able to say, Lord, I've just decided to follow you wherever that leads, because that's a good place. So bless the speaker and the words and the meditations of his mouth, and open our ears and open our hearts, I pray, to something that initially is not something we want to experience. So I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you turn to the book of Ecclesiastes, please? Chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. You probably know these verses. and I will repeat this as I go through my message, but 16 times in 8 verses, you will notice 2 times in each verse, the wisest man in the world says, a time for, or a time to. I don't know, but that strikes me with the repetition that is here, that this is something important. It is something I can't alter. It's above and beyond me. So here's the words of Solomon. There is an appointed time for everything, and there is a time for every event under heaven. Time to give birth and a time to die. Time to plant and a time to uproot what is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, time to tear down, a time to build up, time to weep and a time to laugh, time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw stones and a time to gather them, time to embrace and a time to shun embracing, a time to search and a time to give up as lost, time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear apart, a time to sew together, time to be silent, a time to speak, a time to love, a time to hate, time for war, and a time for peace. If you read the entirety of the book of Ecclesiastes, you will discover that it is about the changing seasons of life. Those changes might have resulted due to our own decisions, good or bad, actions of others, good or bad, unexpected and unfair events of life, and even divine appointment. Paul states in Ephesians 2:10 that we are God's workmanship. And I think God's workmanship in us requires change, because therefore any man that is in Christ is a new creature. Old things are passing away, new things are coming. What's the last new thing God tried to do in your life? I remember the very first thing God tried to do in my life. Became a Christian in 1972 in the Elmira Wesleyan Church, and the first thing God tried to create new in me was my language. Got out of the army, worked in a factory as a tool, or in a shop as a toolmaker and machinist. And for those of you that have been in that places, cursing is a habit that you develop in that place, and you can't talk like that and be a Christian, amen? I mean, it doesn't, the two don't fit together when you're talking about Christ and you're swearing. It just doesn't work together. God seeks to do new things. As I mentioned earlier, a time to, some of your Bibles say there is a season for. I actually like the word seasons better, because we're just out of the fall and hunting seasons are coming. And as you know, I've just retired. That's one of the reasons I'm here today. I would be at Buena Vista as we speak. Our district superintendent is at Buena Vista doing the installation service for the new senior pastor at the Buena Vista Wesleyan Church. That's a big change after 25 years. Don Maynard is here today. I think, Don, you were at Canastillo 32 or 33 years. At the time, he was the longest tenured pastor at the same church. And so maybe I'm experiencing a little bit of what you're experiencing. It's a great relief, don't misunderstand me, but boy, it's a huge change. And a lot of people have been asking me, you know, how you doing? I said, I don't know, it hasn't even been a week yet. And I spent a good part of this week at Buena Vista working in the parsonage. You know, we did the same thing with our parsonage, not quite to the same degree, but complete new kitchen, new flooring all throughout, all new appliances, new windows, lots of stuff. And I'll work at least one day this week finishing up a project. Change is forever on the horizon. If you know me, you know that I am a person that is defined, and Joyce uses the word boring, but I like the normal, I like routine, I like schedule, and I like predictable. I could eat the same thing Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, every week, just rotate it. You know, I tell Joyce, I says, you know, your grocery list is easy. And then she starts trying new stuff. Let me use a little baseball personal experience. I was a pretty good baseball player in high school. Ended my career in my senior year with a batting average of .464. The last 2 years of my baseball experience, we had the privilege of playing our home games at Dunn Field in Elmira, and that was huge for a high school team. And I was the first high school player, and maybe the only high school player, I don't know, to hit a home run out of Dunn Field. And the baseball, as far as I know, still sits in the trophy room if you're in the Southside High School. It was there, but the high school has moved and all of that. And all that was 1967 and 68. That was a long time ago. I was a fastball hitter. I liked the ball just about here. But I had problems with a changeup. Get no pun intended. But a changeup is a change in speed with a little bit of drop in it. And if you've had any baseball experience or if you watch Major League Baseball, every once in a while there is a major league player, including Aaron Judge, who hit two home runs in a game just 2 days ago, that they just look silly swinging at a pitch. And it was usually a changeup. And I was always way out in front of that thing. May I say to you that change is inevitable? And sometimes God throws us some change-ups, and we have difficulty adjusting to them, but how we adjust is extremely important. Right now, by my count, there are 8 churches, and I had a conversation with Matt a little bit. There are 8 churches in our Penn Jersey district that are going through pastoral leadership change. That's huge. That's Don, if you can remember, if we had six, it was a lot. And for years, there would just be one or two because an extended call came into play there. Buena Vista Wesleyan Church, Grace Lee is one of them. So we have something in common. And I would like to share some biblical perspectives on how we should be reacting and embracing this change. But first, I did a little historical research. I knew this. I didn't have to search too far. But this church began on March 18th, 1905, under the leadership of F.B. Hayes in the building that is still standing on Route 414, which was actually disassembled in Pennsylvania, brought up here on train. They didn't have to carry it too far. Tracks are right behind it. And it was reassembled. And that was the meeting place of this church. How many of you were part of it? How many of you attended that building? Okay, a few of you actually were part of attending that building. On September 16th, 1962, the congregation moved to this present location under the leadership of Pastor Wilhelm, and the name changed to Grace Lee Memorial Wesleyan Church, was built by George Lee in memory of his wife, and here we exist today in the extension that has been built. During its existence, 19 different pastors, that's not including assistants, and some of those 19 served more than once. There were 3 of them that were here and served 2 different tenures while they were here. They led this church. So out of what we read in the scriptures and out of that history, let's just reflect on 2 things. First of all, the amount of change and transition that has occurred in the 117 years of this church's history. The average pastoral stay was 6 years. And it's only 6 years because over the last 25 years, guys have stayed longer. Some of them, if you look at the history of the church, some of them stayed only 1 year. One of them stayed only 6 months. And then most of them didn't stay 3 years. That was just the history of the change. I know Pastor Ed Crandall is here. He can remember in his tenure when he was at Buena Vista, we celebrated his 50 years of pastoral service. And in those 50 years, Pastor Ed saw the length of service expand. So think about all that change. I mean, that's a lot, isn't it? And yet church is still here. God has been faithful. Amen? And we are here, and God has something to do, and that leads us to the second point, which is God's faithfulness and directions in the midst of all that change. Men come and go. God stands. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. His word is eternal. We have not added or subtracted from it. Men have come and gone by God's direction, yet his church remains still serving his mission. I commend you for staying the course. I commend you for being here today. So I want to take the word change and I want to use it as an acrostic and present to you some biblical truths as to how we should be reacting and embracing the present change that's taking place. Now I'll pause here just a minute and this is just, I guess, kind of personal. At least today. And Greg, I'm sorry that you had to make the announcements about transition and Randy and Bill. Thank you for what you have said. But it's pretty hard for a pastor who's transitioning and leaving to make announcements about all that transition. Nobody said, Greg didn't say a thing about himself. I believe next Sunday is your last Sunday you speak, and you will be transitioning. Would you just thank Greg for all he's done and the time that he's been there? I mean, and you may have something special planned for him next week, but I can say the staff. And I felt kind of bad at Buena Vista. I announced my retirement in September. Everybody kind of knew it was coming. I was supposed to retire at 70 because Joyce retired at 70 from teaching. But COVID hit, and I just felt I couldn't leave the church at that particular time. And she was gracious about it. In fact, maybe she was glad not to have me around. At home all the time. Now we will be, but Pastor Greg, thank you for all the behind the scenes stuff. Even today, he called me three times this week, making sure that I knew the time and anything I needed, and emails that he made and what's on the screen. So thanks for all that you did, and God bless you. And if you think you're going through change, he doesn't know where he's going yet. But God does. Amen? You may not know where the church is headed right yet, but God knows. Trust him. So let's just go through this. The first letter, C. Could I ask you, could I plead with you, please try to catch the vision, not just that your new pastor might have, and the board and the search committee and the transition committee might have, but what heaven has, because that's what really matters. Where's heaven going to take this church? I ask you, could it be that God, the head of the church, is seeking to catch and direct our hearts for a new season of ministry and outreach? Think of the early church in the book of Acts. In the first chapter of the book of Acts, about 120 people stand watching Jesus ascend into heaven. Jesus is gone. And I can just imagine them thinking, what now? He's gone. He went up into the clouds, and I know that the angels said to them, "Why are you standing around thinking? The same Jesus is going to come back in the same way that he left. Someday, maybe in our lifetime, we're going to look up into the clouds and Jesus isn't going to be going up. He's going to be coming what? What a day that's going to be, right? Because we'll be raptured into a place where time is no more and no more change, I think. You know, one of the characteristics of heaven I rejoice over, no change. Well, I'm not so sure about that. So Jesus ascends into heaven, the day of Pentecost. Can you imagine the confusion? Certainly all of Jerusalem is stirred up. Then you have the persecution and the scattering of the church. Talk about being able to look up to heaven and say, "God, what are you doing?" The church is thriving in Jerusalem, but it's in Jerusalem. And if you remember from Acts chapter 8, Jesus said, "And you will become my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and even to the other parts of the world and of the earth." And the church didn't want to go beyond the boundaries of Jerusalem. Just like Peter didn't want to come back from the Mount of Transfiguration. He said to Jesus, "Lord, let's build a couple tabernacles here and let's stay here. This is a nice place." Jesus said, "No, you got to go home." And by the way, God had a great purpose for the persecution of the church. It scattered them, and they became witnesses to the uttermost parts of the earth. And then the church in Jerusalem had to deal with the reaching out to the Gentiles and all of the struggle that was incurred there. And can you imagine? I don't like them people. You see, all of these difficult and unwanted changes were part of the fulfilling of God's mission. I submit to you, your present transition is part of God fulfilling his mission in a different way. Your new pastor will reach people that the last one didn't. Will bring new ideas, new vision, new strength. God forbid that he would be doing something in our midst and we would refuse to be part of it because we don't like it. Pray and think and look for what God might be doing. Catch the vision. You don't have to know the vision. God already knows that. I'm saying to you, catch it. So you have CH. Please help instead of hurt the process. Your attitude, actions, and words you share with others will either help or hurt unity. And unity, according to Jesus and the Apostle Paul and his teaching of the body of Christ, is the very foundation of the church. In fact, Jesus prayed to his heavenly Father in his high priestly prayer in the book of John that we would be one, even as he and the Father are one. Be an encourager. Be a Barnabas. A, ask the right questions of the right people. None of us like change, yet all of us have legitimate opinions and questions when change occurs. The problem arises when the lines of communication break down or move in the wrong direction. Let's admit that we all tend to gravitate. You've heard the saying, birds of a feather, finish it, will you? Okay. And that happens with opinions. We find people that agree with us. We don't want to sit around and have a good discussion with people that disagree with us. Ask the right questions of the right people. What if our thinking is based solely on feeling or personal preferences and not what's best for the body of Christ? Maybe instead of unfruitful chatter, which is really a nice pastoral term for gossip, We should be going to the people who really know what's going on. When I left Chambers in 1997, a lot of you don't know the situation at Buena Vista. The pastor had morally fallen, had an affair with a lady in the church. He'd been there a total of 23 years in two different stints. The church went from about 310 to about 210 after I arrived, or there was a kind of a year in between where Reverend Jerry Jack was the interim pastor. There were two people in this church that came to me and made a couple of comments that broke my heart. One of them was, "You're only leaving because it's a bigger church and it pays more money and has more prestige." My heart broke when I heard that. I said to that person, I said, "If that's how you really feel after I've served here for 7 years, I'm asking you, you can hold that opinion if you like, but please don't go tell other people what you think." 2 years later, while I was doing archery at children's camp over at Chambers Camp, that person came to me and we sat down and apologized, and I certainly forgave them, and we moved on from there. You see, you might hold your opinions about transition, but they may be very, very wrong. Joyce and I did not want to leave here. We had a 5-year plan in place. We had great friends here. But I knew clearly what God wanted me to do. Be careful that you ask the right questions of the right people. Colossians 4:6 says this, "Let your speech always be seasoned with grace, as it were with salt, so that you may know how you should respond when each person comes to you." How you respond can have a very positive ripple effect, or it can have a very negative ripple effect. And be careful to never fight God. I was at the Wallace Wesleyan Church before I came here. I was there for 10 years. About 3 years in, primarily due to Joyce's children's ministry and work she was doing in the community, I think we had every child in the community of Wallace attending Clubhouse. And the church grew from about 40 people to about 120. We needed more space, and Wallace had a sanctuary and it had an annex that was so old, the carriage house was still behind it. That's where they tied the horses up. Okay? So that got tore down and the building committee started meeting, and there were 6 people that had some experience in building, some of them more than others, but there was an individual named Vern Parker, and I'll tell his name because this ends very positively, although it doesn't begin very well. He's on the building committee. Well, Vern Parker was part of building that old annex building that was, I don't remember how old it was, but it was old. And the building committee had arrived at the point where we're either going to tear the old annex down or we're going to build on the end of it. And the building committee voted to tear down the old annex. Oh, my. I'm sitting in a meeting and Vern Parker gets up and he picks his papers up and he walks out the door. And as he's going out the door, he said, "If that's where we're going, I want no part of it." And he left. And 5 of us are sitting there. We didn't know whether to have a party or to grieve. And I was grieving because I love the guy, because he loved his church, but he just couldn't get over this hurdle. Well, came the day to begin demolition, And all of the building committee is there except for Vern Parker, and he made it very clear to a lot of people that he would have nothing to do with tearing this building down. He pulls in the driveway, and we're standing there, and he walks to the back of his car, and he opens a trunk, and I'm thinking, here's he got a gun, he's going to get out, or what's going to go on here? Well, how is this going to transpire? And I noticed him pick up his old apron, old carpenter's apron, like my grandfather had, where it had the loop over the neck, not just the belt, and tied it around. It was cloth, and it had holes in the nail hole, you know, the pockets for the nails and everything. He grabbed a sledgehammer, put his hammer on his belt and a crowbar, and he came over and he said, I'm here to help. And I thought, now I'm not much of a singer, but I felt like singing, hallelujah, hallelujah. And he helped. And he was there for the duration. He didn't just come help one day. He helped. In Acts chapter 6, verses 34 through 40, we meet an individual named Gamaliel. The church is growing. Peter and James are preaching, and even in the temple. And they throw him in prison, and they're the Sadducees and Pharisees, they're discussing, how do we end this? And here's Gamaliel's final conclusion. He says, and so in this present case, I say to you, leave these men alone. For if this plan or action should be of men, it will be overthrown. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them, or else you may even be found guilty of fighting against God. Whoa! I don't know about you, but I don't want to fight against God. I learned a long time ago, you lose. My God is so strong, so big, and so mighty. There's nothing he cannot do. Gee, please seek to grow through it. Change is one of God's most potent change and growth tools. Remember Paul's thorn in the flesh? Some form of physical infirmity. There's been much speculation as to what it was. We don't actually know. But he prayed 3 times earnestly. If there was anybody I want praying for me, it'd be the Apostle Paul, right? 3 times he asked God, please remove this. And he had good reason for wanting it removed. It impeded his missionary work. Yet Paul's greatest blessing, hear this, was not to be healing. It was grace sufficient to live with the change that was occurring. In Buena Vista, as we grew, it was just prior before going to 2 services and then planning New Hope in Hornell, we had, how many of you remember Myrtle Carruthers? Every time I go past Myrtle's house, I rejoice that I had the chance of knowing her well. At Buena Vista, I had a Rosie Smith, and she had several ladies. Every Sunday, they'd come to church. There'd be 4 of them. They'd sit together, and they'd go out to church after lunch, or go out to lunch after church. And one day, I was walking down the aisle, and was at the time where we were making changes and transition from a traditional service, which was almost all hymns, to worship choruses and a blended service that included at least one hymn. I was going down the aisle one day, and one of the ladies reached up and grabbed my arm and yanked. And when old people grab your arm, the first thing that comes to your mind, oh no, what are they going to want? Or what are they going to complain about now? But let me say this. The elderly in our churches have given up far more than the younger people have given up. Amen? So, I stopped and I said, what's up? And I think they had this rehearsed because all four of them said in unison, "We don't like the music." That's the first words out of their mouth. I know you don't like the music. I don't like the music. I would rather have all hymns, although the music today, don't misunderstand, that's where I land. That's my tradition. And that's why Buena Vista always has at least one hymn in its midst, in its worship set. But they said something else that changed the whole tenure of that service for me. If I would have had to gone to the pulpit preaching with those words in my mind, we don't like the music. Here's what they said. But we love all the young families here. And I said to him, you got it. You caught it. You see it. You're willing to change for the sake of other people. Rosie. Rosie made the best scalloped potatoes of anybody I ever knew. Even better than Dorothy Kennedy's. E, let's end this. Expect ongoing change. Notice that our text never says that in this life there is a season of no more change. Oh, I know as Christians someday we will be ushered into the place where time will be no more, but as long as we tarry, change will occur. Praise God that He brings change. Praise God that He is with us through all of that change. While we were here, and although of not late because of COVID, Buena Vista and the Chambers Church was always involved in doing services at skilled nursing facilities. I tried to end almost every one of those services with the hymn, "God Will Take Care of You." The chorus, or one of the verses, goes like this: God will take care of you through every day or all the way. God will take care of you. From my heart, as I conclude, and in the midst of my preparation for this message, I wrote myself a note and to God. It's pretty simple. God, even after preparing this message, I still don't like change. But by your grace, I will follow you through it. That's what I'm asking of you today. By God's grace, make it through. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, help us as human beings, because to us, change is not just difficult. Sometimes it's repulsive. Sometimes we're like the nation of Israel wandering in the wilderness, and you've got a great vision and change in mind, and they were just grumbling and groaning about this and about that. You got them ready to go into the promised land, and they couldn't see it, and they didn't cooperate in it. So they ended up 40 years wandering in the wilderness before they entered that land. God forbid, God forbid, that we would be days or weeks or months or years when we wouldn't embrace your change and say, Lord, this is going to be hard, but I'll follow you through it. I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. So whatever you have in mind, Jesus, we'd like to be a part of it. We ask it in His precious name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. If you would stand for the benediction, I'm going to be reading from Colossians 4. I picked out verse 2 and 3, and he read 6. And I think it's appropriate just to read this small paragraph here as we go, because we as believers are called to act. in a way that is in line with his word. Colossians 4, 2 through 6, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too that God may open doors for our message so that we may proclaim the mysteries of Christ. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders and make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be filled with grace, seasoned with salt, so you may know how to answer everyone. Be devoted to one another in prayer, be thankful, and let your words be seasoned with grace. You are dismissed.
So glad you came to save us.